glory.
And the glory.
Forever.
Forever.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
For he is good.
For he is good.
For his mercy endureth forever.
For his mercy endureth forever.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
For he is good.
For he is good.
For his mercy endureth forever.
For his mercy endureth forever.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen. Today's scripture reading comes from Psalms 86, verses 1 through 7. Bow down thine ear, O Lord. Hear me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my soul, for I am holy. O thou my God, save thy servant that trusteth in thee. Be merciful unto me, O Lord, for I cry unto thee daily. Rejoice the soul of thy servant, for unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. For thou, Lord, art good and ready to forgive, and plenteous in mercy unto all them that come upon thee, that call upon thee. Give ear, O Lord, unto my prayer, and attend to the voice of my supplications. In the day of my trouble, I will call upon thee, for thou wilt answer me. And again, this is from Psalms 86, verses 1 through 7. May the Lord add a blessing to the hearing, reading, and doing of his word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Okay, we're going to have a selection from the kids' choir and the adults.
Happy Sabbath. So you came and changed my life. You thought I was worth keeping.
Happy Sabbath.
I just wanna praise you
forever.
Forever.
And ever.
And ever.
And ever.
And ever.
For all,
for all
you've done for me.
For me.
Blessings and glory.
Blessings and glory.
Forever,
forever
in thing you've
and
done
ever,
and every way you've
and
made
ever.
Okay, let's get the choir another hand. Praise to the Most High God, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And peace to everyone that's here today in the name of Jesus. Peace to everyone that's watching us on the internet. And as always, it's good to stand before you on the Lord's Sabbath day. Today, like we, you know, we always do every Sabbath, teach out of the Bible. And, you know, we're going to teach a little bit about death today. It's not a pretty subject, but it's in the Bible for a reason. And those of us who have some understanding know that death is just an interruption in life. That's all it is. Because once the interruption is over with, you're going to live again. You know, you're going to live again. But it all depends on, you know, how you lived before you died. Because there's a lake of fire where wicked people are going to end up. And then there's the kingdom with the Father and the Son where the righteous people are going to end. But you're going to live eternally. It just depends on where you're going to live at, what house you're going to be in. But let's get into the lesson. We're going to start in Genesis 2 because it's hard, you know, to see family members go. But, you know, when you actually see someone that you know that's in the truth, you know, when they pass or when they die, and you know, it's kind of tragic, you know. And, you know, I had to experience that because Elijah, you know, he told me, because we did a couple, about three or four funerals in here, but I never actually personally knew the individuals that died, but they were in the truth. But this last individual, you know, I pretty much knew him for like 5 years, you know. And when, you know, that brother passed, and we just did his memorial last Sunday, but that one really kind of hurt. But, you know, death is not a pretty picture. And when people die, you know, there's mourning involved and sorrow. But, you know, those of us that are in the truth know that there's more to it after that, if you lived right. But let's look at it, because death wasn't part of the creation. In the beginning, it wasn't part of it, but man brought it in. And from that point on, people are dying daily. Somebody just died a couple seconds ago, you know? And how, you know, some died instantly. Some have a pestilence or an affliction that, you know, that they die slowly. And that's probably just as painful as not knowing when death hits you, you know? Because knowing you're going to die is different than when you just die all of a sudden. But either way, you don't know when it's going to happen. But let's get into the lesson. I'm talking too much. Genesis 2. Genesis 2, we're going to pick it up in the beginning. Because in the creation, the Lord made everything good, and death was not a part of it. Man just ate of the wrong tree and brought death into the creation. Genesis 2 and verse 4, what does it say?
These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, and every plant of the field before it was in the earth, and every herb of the field before it grew. For the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, that there was not a man to till the ground. But then there went up a mist from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul.
So now the Lord God formed man out of the dust and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and now man has come alive. Go ahead.
And the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and there he put the man whom he had formed. And out of the ground made the Lord God grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of knowledge of good and evil.
So out of the ground the Lord God made to grow every tree that's pleasant to the sight and good for food, the tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. skip down to verse 15 and read it, because he gave man a directive. Go ahead.
And the Lord God took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die.
So the Lord God commanded the man. He said, look, you can eat of every tree in the garden, but the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, don't even eat it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof, that's the day you're going to die. Go ahead.
And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helpmeet for him.
Keep reading, man.
And out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all the cattle and to the fowls of the air and to every beast of the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helpmeet for him.
So the Lord gonna make a helpmeet for Adam. We read a little too much. That was my fault. Go to chapter 3. So he made the woman for the man. And let's see if she understood what the Lord told Adam. 3:1, what it say?
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden?
So now he questioned her. He said, look, did God say you shouldn't eat of every tree in the garden? What did she say?
And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die.
So she said, you know, she said, yeah, God said we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but the fruit of the tree was in the midst of the garden. He said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest ye die. So she understood the directive. Go ahead.
And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil.
So Satan directly contradicted God. God said you're going to die. Satan said you're not going to die. Now who are you going to believe? Nowadays, people believe in Satan. But he said, look, now he gave her a little truth too. He said, for God doth know in the day you eat thereof, your eyes going to be opened, and you're going to be as gods, knowing good and evil. And that, oh, man, I could be like God? What? What else you got to say, man? Go ahead.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and the tree was to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat.
So she was captivated by the conversation because that's all that was going on. She wasn't eating no apple or no orange or no fig, whatever it was. This was all conversation. And when a woman saw that the tree was good for food, it was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit, did eat, gave it to Adam. He ate, and what happened? Verse 7.
And the eyes of both of them were open, and they knew that they were naked.
All of a sudden, their eyes got open. It wasn't about no good and evil no more. They were like, hold on, man, we naked. We better cover ourselves up. Go ahead.
And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons.
So they sewed some fig leaves together, made themselves aprons. And here come God walking around, called Adam. Adam said, I heard you in the garden, so I hid myself because I was naked. And the Lord told him, who told you you was naked, man? Have you eaten of the tree that I told you not to eat of? So he blamed it on the woman. The woman blamed it on the devil. Now the Lord going to start handing out sentences. He got the devil first, he got the woman, now he's going to get to the man. Verse 17, read it.
And unto Adam he said, because thou hast hearkened unto the voice of thy wife.
Because you listened to your wife, go ahead.
And hast eaten of the tree.
And you ate of the tree, go ahead.
Of which I commanded thee, saying, thou shalt not eat of it. Cursed is the ground for thy sake.
So now the ground going to be cursed, go ahead.
In sorrow shalt thou eat of it all the days of thy life. Thorns also and thistles shall it bring forth to thee, and thou shalt eat the herb of the field. In the sweat of thy face thou shalt eat bread.
You're going to have a hard time, man. Your life's going to be hard now. thorns and thistles, and sorrow you're going to eat of it all the days of your life until what? Go ahead.
Till thou return into the ground. For out of it wast thou taken, for dust thou art, and thou thus shalt thou return.
So now, he told him, you're going to work hard till you die, and you're going to return to the ground, because that's where you came from. But dust thou art, and to dust thou shalt return. But before you die, my friend, you're going to have a hard life. Let's go to Ezekiel 18. Ezekiel 18. So it don't matter who you are, righteous or wicked. If you're not living when the Lord come back, you're going to die. And that's pretty much it. And it's all in the hands of the Lord. He knows when your number is up. The thing about it is you don't know. That's why you got to keep your garments white at all times. Because you never know. You never know. 18 and 4, what it say?
Behold, all souls are mine.
All souls belong to the Lord. Every last one of us. Good or evil, go ahead.
As the soul of the Father, so is also the souls of the Son is mine. The soul that sinneth, it shall die.
So the soul that sinneth, it's going to die. Skip down to verse 20 and read.
The soul that sinneth, it shall die. The Son shall not bear the iniquity of the Father, neither shall the Father bear the iniquity of the Son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him.
So just because the daddy messed up, the son shouldn't have to suffer, even though the house becomes in disarray because the head that messed up. Just because pops messed up, that don't mean you have to follow in his footsteps. You may suffer a little bit because of what he did, but you got to keep yourself on the straight and narrow. The soul of the sinner is going to die. The righteousness of the righteous is going to be upon him, and the wickedness of the wicked shall be upon him. Go ahead.
But if the wicked will return from all his sins that he hath committed, and keep all my statutes that do that which is lawful and right, he shall surely live, and he shall not die.
Keep reading, man.
All his transgressions that he hath committed, they shall not be mentioned unto him. In his righteousness that he hath done, he shall live. Have I any pleasure at all that the wicked should die, saith the Lord God, and not that he should return from his ways and live?
That's something the Lord has said. Look, he don't have no pleasure in killing the wicked. He wants the wicked to return from his wicked ways and live, start doing righteousness. But if he happens to make that choice, death is on the table. You got to make the choice. Ecclesiastes 9. Ecclesiastes 9. It's not a pretty picture. It wasn't meant to be. It's not supposed to be. Death is pure evil because it wasn't supposed to happen. And however it happens, you know, young, old, it happens. Babies die. Old people die. Young people die, and everybody in between. Ecclesiastes 9 and 1, what does it say?
For all this, I considered in my heart, even to declare all this, that the righteous and the wise and their works are in the hands of God. No man knoweth either love or hatred by all that is before them. All things come alike to all. There is one event to the righteous and the wicked, and to the wicked, to the good and to the clean, and to the unclean, to him that sacrifices and to them that sacrificeth not. As is the good, so is the sinner, and he that sweareth as he that feareth an oath.
So all things come alike. And there's one event to the righteous, the wicked, good, clean, whatever it is, whatever your state of mind is, however you act, what is that event? Verse 3, go ahead.
It is an evil among all things that are done under the sun.
And what this event is evil. Go ahead.
That there is one event unto all. Yea, also the heart of the sons of men is full of evil and madness is in their heart while they live.
So were all the hearts of the sons of man is full of evil and madness is in their hearts while they live. And after that, what happens?
And after that, they go to the dead.
And after that, you die. That's pretty much plain and simple. While you living, you living. When you ain't living, you dead. That's it. Go ahead.
For to him that is joined to all the living, there is hope.
So as long as you living, you got hope. And that hope is what? The helmet of your salvation? That's hope. You want this eternal life. Go ahead.
For a living dog is better than a dead lion.
A living dog is better. I don't care how bad that lion is. And how many giraffes and buffaloes he done killed. But when he dead, he ain't worth nothing. A living dog is better than him. One of them little rat dogs, too. That's better than a dead lion. Go ahead.
For the living know that they shall die. But the dead know not anything, neither have they any more a reward, for the memory of them is forgotten.
So the living know that they're going to die, but the dead, they don't know nothing. They don't even talk either, like some people want you to believe. Neither they have any more reward under the sun, because their memory of them is gone. Go ahead, what else is gone?
Also their love and their hatred and their envy is now perished.
So whatever love and hatred they had in their heart, it died with them. Go ahead.
Neither have they any more a portion forever in anything that is done under the sun.
So ain't no, they have no more portion. They ain't got nothing else coming. So ain't no sense in having birthdays for dead people. Because they don't even know that they're around. They don't even know they're dead. That's the thing about it. You dead and you don't even know it. That's why the Bible calls it sleep. And eventually you get to wake up out of that sleep. But until then, you sleeping. And you don't know nothing. Keep reading.
Go thy way. Eat thy bread with joy. And drink thy wine with a merry heart. For God now accepteth thy works.
So while you live right, eat your bread with joy. Drink the wine with a good heart. For God accepteth thy works. Go ahead.
Let thy garments be always white. And let thy head lack no ointment.
So while you living joyfully, make sure that your garments are always white. Go ahead.
Live joyfully with the wife whom thou lovest all the days of the life of thy vanity, which he had given thee under the sun, all the days of thy vanity, for that is thy portion in this life, and in thy labor which thou takest under the sun.
So you got a wife, live with it joyfully. You got a job, enjoy it while you got it. Go ahead.
Whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. For there is no work, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave whither thou goest.
So whatever you find to do, do it with all your might. Give it 100%. Because there's no work, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave when you're gone. Because once you stop breathing, it's a wrap. It's over with. And for those of us that have understanding, we know there's more to it than that. Death is just an interruption. It's like when you're watching them TV shows and that loud thing beep come across and they interrupt a good show, man. But once the interruption is over, it starts up again, right? Same way with life. Death is interrupting life. And once you wake up again, you start a new life. Go ahead.
I return and saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither yet bread to the wise, nor yet riches to the men of understanding, nor yet favor to men of skill.
So I saw under the sun that the race is not always to the swift. The fastest guy don't always win. On paper, he should, but sometimes the fastest guy loses because there's somebody faster than him. So the race is not always to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, neither the bread to the wise, nor risen men understanding. Go ahead, what's happening to them?
But time and chance happeneth to them all.
But time and chance happeneth to all. Go ahead.
For man also knoweth not his time.
So man don't know his time. That's the thing about it. We don't know. Only God knows when your number's up. Go ahead.
As the fishes that are taken in an evil net, and as the birds that are caught in a snare, so are the sons of men snared in an evil time, when it falleth suddenly upon them.
So like the fishes are taken in a net, you know, the fishes, all they do is swim. Ain't nothing on their mind but swimming and eating. But all of a sudden, they end up caught in the net and end up on your plate. They didn't even think about that. And at the same time, so are the sons of men snared in an evil time when it falleth suddenly upon them. What is that? Death. Suddenly upon them, man. We finished that?
Yes, we did.
Let's move on. Isaiah 57. Mm-hmm. So you don't know.
Chapter 3, verses 1-8.
Yeah, go to chapter 3. Flip back to chapter 3. So you don't know when your time is. And you know, people walking around, they ain't got no fear of God in them at all. Just do what they want to do. Could care less about dying. 3:1, what it say?
To everything, there's a season and a time to every purpose.
So everything, there's a season, there's a time for every purpose. What are they? Go ahead.
Under the heaven, a time to be born.
It's a time to be born.
And a time to die.
And a time to die.
A time to plant. A time to pluck up that which is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down. And a time to build up.
So there's a time to be born, a time to die, plant, pluck up, time to kill, and a time to heal. Go ahead.
A time to weep, and a time to laugh. A time to mourn, and a time to dance. A time to cast away stones, and a time to gather stones together. A time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to get, and a time to lose. A time to keep, and a time to cast away. A time to rend, and a time to sow. A time to keep silence, and a time to speak. A time to love, and a time to hate. A time of war, and a time of peace.
So that pretty much covered everything. It's a time for everything. He covered it all. But we're dealing with a time to be born and a time to die. There is a time to die. Isaiah 57. Let's see. The thing about it, you don't know. Especially that sudden death, man. That's the thing, you know, that hit most people when they die suddenly. Some people have cancer, which is a slow death. Doctors may give you, depending on what you got, 3 or 4 months to live. But that's putting something heavy on your mind. You're like, well, I got 3 months to live, man. And then other people get hit by trucks. People get shot. Like this one guy that got shot, what was it, a couple days ago? I'm quite sure he didn't wake up in the morning thinking he was gonna get shot that day. But it happened. Isaiah 57:1, read it.
The righteous perisheth, and no man layeth it to heart. And the merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous is taken away from evil to come. He shall enter into peace, they shall rest in their beds, each one walking in his uprightness.
So now good people, right? The righteous perisheth, and no man layeth to heart, and merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous are taken away from the evil to come. So whatever the Lord had planned for the righteous individual, he took. Apparently he took them so they wouldn't have to experience no evil that's about to come down. So good people die for a reason, just like wicked people die for a reason. But it's all in the Lord. He shall enter into peace. They shall rest in their beds, each one walking in his uprightness. Flip back to 38. Flip back to chapter 38. Let's read some more. So it all depends on how you was walking when you was living. And that's what we're trying to accomplish here. Get an understanding of this interruption. Because it's going to happen. So when your life is interrupted, make sure you was right when it got interrupted. 38:1, let's look at this guy. Now Hezekiah, he was a good king. 38:1, read it, man.
In those days was Hezekiah sick unto death.
He was sick unto death. In other words, he getting ready to die. Go ahead.
And Isaiah the prophet, the son of Amoz, came unto him and said unto him, thus saith the Lord, set thine house in order, for thou shalt die.
So Isaiah came to him and told him, look, man, get your house in order because you're getting ready to die. Hard words, you know. He didn't try to sugarcoat nothing. Get your house in order, man, because you're going to die. Go ahead.
And not live. Then Hezekiah turned his face toward the wall and prayed unto the Lord.
He did some heavy praying, because apparently the man wasn't ready to die. But when the prophet told him, he prayed to the Lord, go ahead.
And said, remember now, O Lord, I beseech thee, how I have walked before thee in truth and with a perfect heart, and have done that which is good in thy sight.
So he told him, he laid his resume out to the Lord. He said, look, Lord, I walked before you in truth with a perfect heart and done that which is good. And he did some crying too. Go ahead.
And Hezekiah wept sore.
He did some heavy crying. He was crying. Look, I don't want to die, Lord. I don't want to die. Go ahead.
Then came the word of the Lord to Isaiah saying, go, say to Hezekiah, thus saith the Lord, the God of David, thy father, I have heard thy prayer. I have seen thy tears. Behold, I'll add unto thee, unto thy days 15 years.
So he gave him 15 more years. He prolonged his death. But he pretty much knew in 15 years I'm a dead man. So he knew when he was going to die. 15 years from the time he got that message. But he was a good man. The Lord extended his life. It's just like, you know, when doctors tell you only got something, because we had this one brother at the ILG, you know, he had the leukemia. And they only gave him, you know, like, I believe it was like 6 months. But he ended up having, I think it was like 2.5 years that he lived till the leukemia got him. So you don't know. The Lord can extend your lifespan. And he could cut it short too. But you don't know that. All you got to do is keep your house in order. We finished that?
Yeah, that's it.
Let's go to John 7. So he gave him 15 years. So he prayed to the Lord. You know, we had the brother, he had, cancer. And we prayed for him, you know, anointed him. Who knows what the Lord could do? He could have delivered him from it. But that wasn't the case, you know. The brother ended up dying. And from what I can see, or as long as he was here, you know, all I can see, he was keeping the Sabbath, keeping the high days, dietary law, you know. His resume looks good according to the book. John 7:1, read it.
After these things, Jesus walked in Galilee, for he would not walk in Judea because Jews sought to kill him.
So now here's Jesus. They're trying to kill him. And this is the second individual that we can read about who knew when they was getting ready to die. And knew their time, the exact day, and everything else. Go ahead.
Now the Jews' Feast of the Tabernacles was at hand. His brethren therefore said unto him, depart hence, and go into Judea, that thy disciples also may see the work that thou doest. For there is no man that doeth anything in secret, and he himself seeketh to be known openly. If thou do these things, show thyself to the world.
So now his brothers, you know, they didn't believe him at first. They was mocking him, saying, look, man, you do all this good stuff. Go on up to Judea and show yourself openly. Go ahead.
For neither did his brethren believe in him.
But they didn't believe him. But Jesus has some cold words for him. Go ahead.
Then Jesus said unto them, my time is not yet come.
He told them, look, my time is not yet come. It ain't time for me to die. Go ahead.
But your time is always ready.
But your time is always ready. It means you could die at any time. Go ahead.
The world cannot hate you, but me it hateth, because I testify of it, and the works thereof are evil. Go ye up unto this feast. I go not up yet unto this feast, for For not my time not yet come forth.
So he told them, y'all go ahead. It ain't my time yet. I still got some more work to do. Verse 9, read that too.
When he had said these words unto them, he abode still in Galilee.
But he eventually went up to the feast. Skip down to 14 and read it.
Now about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught. And the Jews marveled, saying, how knoweth this man letters, having never learned? Jesus answered them and said, my doctrine is not mine, but his that sent me. If any man do his will, he shall know the doctrine, whether it be of God or whether I speak of myself.
So he went up to the temple and taught, and they was like, wait a minute, man. How do you know all this, man? You ain't never been to no university. You ain't got no doctorate of theology. You ain't got nothing. You a carpenter's son. Where you get all this knowledge from? But that's how the Lord worked. You don't need a doctorate by your name to have some understanding of this book. Practically everybody that's up in this position right here has been locked up, off the streets. I ain't never went to college. Never wanted to go. I got a high school diploma, that's it. But I got a master's in this Bible that could tear down a Sunday preacher that went to a school of theology. And that's the understanding from God. So God's wisdom, you can tear anybody down. But keep reading, man.
He that seeketh of himself seeketh his own glory, but he that seeketh his glory that sent him, the same is true, and no unrighteousness is in him.
And that's what a servant of God do. We ain't seeking no glory. We trying to get you to get some salvation. It ain't about us. It ain't about me. It's about you trying to get into this kingdom. And that's what we're here to do. We can all get some understanding. He that speaketh of himself seek his own glory. Go ahead.
Did not Moses give you the law, and yet none of you keepeth the law? Why you go about to kill me?
So he told him, look, Moses gave you the law and you don't even keep it. You looking to kill me. Go ahead.
The people answered and said, thou hast a devil. Who goes about to kill thee?
So they pretty much told him, man, you crazy. Ain't nobody trying to kill you, but they lying. Go ahead.
Jesus answered and said unto them, I have done one work and ye all marvel. Moses therefore gave unto you circumcision, not because it is of Moses, but of the fathers. And he on the Sabbath day circumcised a man. If a man on the Sabbath day receives circumcision, that the law of Moses should not be broken, are ye angry at me, because I have made a man every whit whole on the Sabbath day?
So now, he told him, look, Moses gave you circumcision, not because of his Moses, but of the fathers. And on the Sabbath day you circumcise a man. But keep reading. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Judge not according to the appearance, but judge righteous judgment. Then said some of them of Jerusalem, is not he who may seek to kill? But lo, he speaketh boldly, and they say nothing unto him. Do the rulers know indeed that this is the very Christ? Howbeit we know this man whence he is, but when Christ cometh, no man knoweth whence he is. Then cried Jesus in the temple, he taught, saying, ye both know me, and ye know whence I am. And I am not come of myself, but he that sent me is true, whom ye know not. But I know him, for I am from him, and he has sent me. Then they had sought to take him, but no man laid hands on him, because his hour was not yet come.
So all that good teaching Jesus was doing, they were still trying to kill him. But they didn't touch him because it was not his time yet. Go to John 11. He knew when he was going to die. They even tried to push him off a cliff, man. Israel is crazy. Well, they out to get you, boy. John 11. Flip over to John 11. Let's read this. John 11. In verse 1, read.
Now a certain man was sick named Lazarus of Bethany, the town of Mary, and her sister Martha.
Now here's Lazarus. He had a sister named Mary and Martha. They was walking with Jesus. And Jesus really liked this dude, boy. Keep reading.
It was that Mary which anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was sick. Therefore his sisters went unto him, saying, Lord, behold, he whom thou lovest is sick. When Jesus heard that, he said, this sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God might be glorified thereby. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. When he had heard, therefore, that he was sick, he abode 2 days still in the same place where he was.
Now Jesus loved Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. But when he heard he was sick, he hung around for a couple more days because there was a plan in effect here. Now go ahead.
Then after saith he to his disciples, let us go into Judea again. His disciples say unto him, Master, the Jews of late sought to stone thee, and goest thou thither again?
So now Jesus told him, let's go to Judea. And disciples tried to talk him out of it. Like, look, man, they tried to kill you there. Why are you going back? Go ahead.
Verse 11. These things said he, and after that saith unto them, our friend Lazarus sleepeth, but I go, that I may awake him out of sleep. Then said his disciples, Lord, if he sleep, he shall do well. Howbeit, Jesus spake of his death, but they thought that he had spoken of taking rest and sleep.
So now Jesus told them, Lazarus is asleep, but I got to go wake him up. And they actually thought he was sleeping. But Jesus was telling them, look, he dead. So he had to pretty much make it plain to him. What did he tell him? Go ahead.
Then Jesus said unto them plainly, Lazarus is dead.
He's like, man, I ain't talking about no sleep, man. This cat is dead. He is dead. Now we got to go wake him up. Keep reading.
And I'm glad for your sakes that I was not there, to the intent ye may believe. Nevertheless, let us go unto him. Then said Thomas, which is called Didymus, unto his fellow disciples, let us also go, that we may die with him.
So now Thomas was like, oh man, this cat, dude, they tried to kill us there, man. We can't let him, we might as well all go so we can all die. Go ahead.
Then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave for 4 days already.
So he'd been dead 4 days. And not only that, he was stinking too. That's what the book say. Where we at?
21.
Skip down to 21 and read.
Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died.
Now they really upset. Now they hurting because their brother's gone. And death is pretty sorrowful. They told Jesus, look, man, if you'd have been here, my brother wouldn't have died. Go ahead.
But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again.
So he told her, look, your brother, he's going to rise again. But she didn't know he was talking about right then and there. But she had some understanding. What did she say? Go ahead.
Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the day.
I know he's going to rise again in the resurrection at the last day. So Martha has some understanding. She has some understanding. I'm going to see him again in the last day when he get resurrected. Go ahead.
Jesus saith unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, ye shall he live. And whoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this?
So Jesus said, I'm the resurrection. I'm the life. Believe in me, even though if you're dead, you're going to live. You will live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. So if you believe in Jesus and you die believing in him, guess what? He's going to wake you up and you're going to live again. And if you live and believe in him, you ain't going to die. That's why some people that are righteous, when Jesus come back, they ain't going to die. They're going to be changed right there on the spot because they believed. Go to John 1 Kings 14. Is that right? Yeah. 1 Kings 14. So that's what we're doing while we're living. And if we happen to die in Jesus, we're going to live again. And those of us that are living, when Jesus come back, ain't going to die. Now that's some hope to look forward to. That's why serving a God, they don't want to die. But hey, if it happens, they ain't gonna know anyway. All they know is that they died right, walking in the Lord. 1 Kings 14:1, read.
At the time, Abijah, the son of Jeroboam, fell sick. And Jeroboam said to his wife, "Arise, I pray thee, and disguise thyself, that thou be not known to be the wife of Jeroboam."
Now here's Jeroboam. He was the first king of the northern kingdom when they split. And the guy was wicked. But you know, wicked people have kids too. And when their kids get sick, they get sad. Keep reading.
"And get thee to Shiloh. Behold, there is Ahiah, the prophet, which told me that I should be king over this people. And take with thee 10 loaves and cracknels and a cruse of honey, and go to them. He shall tell thee what shall become of the child."
But because the man was wicked, he sent his wife and told her, "Look, put on a disguise and go see this guy. Because I done did some bad stuff, and you know, I don't want him to know it's you. Because I'm not a good man." But keep reading.
"And Jeroboam's wife did so, and arose and went to Shiloh, and came to the house of Ahiah. But Ahiah could not see, for his eyes were set by reason of his age."
So now she went to the Shiloh, but Ahijah was old and he couldn't see. Go ahead.
"And the Lord said to Ahiah, before the wife of Jeroboam cometh to ask a thing of thee for her son, for he is sick, thus and thus shalt thou say unto her, for it shall be, when she cometh in, that she shall feign herself to be another woman."
So the Lord already gave him the heads up. Jeroboam's wife is coming to see you. She in disguise. She want to know what's going to happen to their son. And you're going to tell her this. Keep reading.
"And it was so, when Ahiah heard the sound of her feet as she came in at the door, and he said, come in, thou wife of Jeroboam. Why feignest thou thyself to be another?"
So as soon as he heard her feet, he told her, "Look, come in, old wife. I know who you are. Why are you trying to trick yourself, disguise yourself to be somebody else? I'm going to tell you some heavy tidings. Go ahead.
For I am sent to thee with heavy tidings."
So I'm sent to you with heavy tidings. This is what's about to go down. Skip down to verse. I want you to read 10. Skip down to 10 and read it.
"Therefore, behold, I will bring evil upon the house of Jeroboam, and will cut off Jeroboam, him that pisseth against the wall, and him that is shut up and left in Israel."
So what is going to bring that evil? The Lord said, "I'm going to bring evil." And what is that evil? It's death. He told him, "Look, I'm going to kill everybody in your lineage. Go ahead."
"And him that is shut up and left in Israel, and will take away the remnant of the house of Jeroboam, as a man taketh away dung, till it all be gone. Him that dieth of Jeroboam in the city shall the dogs eat, and him that dieth in the field shall the fowls of the air eat, for the Lord hath spoken it."
So the dog's going to eat you up. The bird's going to eat you up. The Lord is real creative on how to kill you. Keep reading.
"Arise, therefore, get thee to thine own house, and when thy feet entered into the city, the child shall die."
So now those are the tidings I'm telling you. I'm going to cut off everybody in the household. As soon as your feet hit the city, the child is going to die. Go ahead.
"And Jeroboam's wife arose and departed and came to Tirzah. And when she came to the threshold of the door, the child died."
As soon as she got there, boom, child is dead. Just like that. Go ahead.
"And they buried him, and all Israel mourned for him, according to the word of the Lord, which he spake by the hand of his servant Ahiah, the prophet."
Hold up, man. You missed something. Read verse 13.
Verse 13?
Yeah.
Oops, my bad.
Stay out the lesson, man. Just read. Go ahead.
"And all Israel shall mourn for him and bury him, for he only of Jeroboam shall come to the grave, because in him there is found some good thing toward the Lord of God of Israel in the house of Jeroboam."
So that was the only child that made it to the grave. Everybody else got ate up by dogs, birds, but the Lord saw some good in this child, so he killed him. Keep reading, 14.
Moreover, the Lord shall raise him up a king over Israel, who shall cut off the house of Jeroboam that day.
Okay, but that's good on that. Go to 2 Samuel. So we see kids die, children die. And nothing's changed today. Like I said, people are dying. Somebody just died a second ago right now. Somewhere. But it's all coming from the Lord. He's controlling everything. He will interrupt your life with some death. 2 Samuel 12. Everybody know what David did? Slept with another man's wife. Had the man killed. Then had a son. Because she ended up getting pregnant. That's why he had her killed. Had him killed. Because he wouldn't go back home. David was pretty slick in his, he wanted to pass the baby off as his to Uriah, but he was an honorable man. So the only other solution, he had him killed. But let's see what the Lord weighed in on it. Verses 12 and 10, read.
Now therefore, the sword shall never depart from thine house.
So he told him, I'm gonna mess your house up, man. I'm gonna mess it up because of what you did. That's what happens when the head of the house messes up. The whole house is in disarray. David's son was chasing him all over the place trying to kill him. One of his sons raped his own sister. And that other, her brother killed him. The sword shall never depart from your house. Go ahead.
Because thou hast despised me and hast taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife. Thus saith the Lord, behold, I will raise up evil against thee out of thine own house, and I will take thine wives before thine eyes and give them unto thy neighbor, and he shall lie with thy wives in the sight of this son. For thou didst it secretly, but I will do these things before all Israel and before the sun. And David said unto Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. And Nathan said to David, the Lord also hath put away thy sin. Thou shalt not die.
So he told him, look, you did this in secret. I'm going to do something to you in front of everybody. Everybody going to see it. I knew this one dude, man. He was with this woman, you know. They was living in the, his parents, they had a house over another house, outside of the house. They was living there, living good. And this cat, he was cheating on his woman. And she found out and told his parents, because they was living right there. Put him on blast in front of his own parents. Look at your son, look what he's doing. Then his parents started to hate their own son. But that's how the Lord do it. You try to do something in secret, guess what? When you get busted, everybody know. Whoever you cheated on, they gonna tell everybody. You pretty much, the covers are pulled off of you. And that's how it is when you get caught. But keep reading, man.
Howbeit, because that by this seed thou hast given great occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme, the child also that is born unto thee shall surely die.
But that child that you had, because you did this, it's going to give the enemies great occasion to blaspheme the Lord. They were like, they're going to be like, hey, man, David slept with somebody's wife and got a baby and got away with it. That's adultery. Come on. That's why the Lord had to kill that child. He had to kill it. The child that is born unto you, it's going to die. Go ahead.
And Nathan departed unto his house. And the Lord struck the child that Uriah's wife bare unto David. And it was very sick.
Who struck that child?
The Lord did.
Go ahead.
David therefore besought God for the child. And David fasted and went in and lay all night upon the earth.
So the child got sick, and what did David do? He petitioned the Lord, man. He fasted, lay all night upon the ground. Go ahead.
And the elders of his house arose and went to him and raised him up from the earth. But he would not, neither did he eat bread with them.
So he was like dead weight. They couldn't even pick this dude up. He just wanted to lay there. He didn't even eat. Go ahead.
And it came to pass on the seventh day that the child died.
7 days later, the Lord killed him. Had that child suffering for 7 days, and David watched it all because of what he did. And on the seventh day, the child died. Go ahead.
And the servants of David feared to tell him that the child was dead. For they said, behold, while the child was yet alive, we spake unto him, and he would not hearken unto our voice. How will he then vex himself if we tell him that the child is dead?
So while the child was alive, he wouldn't say nothing to us. Now he's going to really be mad when we tell him he's dead. He's going to be vexed. Go ahead.
But when David saw that his servant whispered, David perceived that the child was dead. Therefore, David said unto the servants, is the child dead? And they said, he is dead.
So here's a servant of God now. He perceived the child was dead, so he needed some confirmation. He asked him, is the child dead? And he was like, yep, he gone. Go ahead.
Then David arose from the earth and washed and anointed himself and changed his apparel and came unto the house of the Lord and worshiped. Then he came to his own house. And when he required, they set bread before him. He did, and he did eat.
So David got up, cleaned himself up, anointed himself, went into the house of the Lord, worshiped, came back. I'm hungry. Give me something to eat. Go ahead.
Then said his servants unto him, what thing is this that thou hast done? Thou didst fast and weep for the child while it was alive. But when the child was dead, thou didst rise and eat bread. And he said, while the child was yet alive, I fasted and wept. For I said, who can tell whether God will be gracious to me that the child may live?
And that's what he did, because you don't know. He said, while the child was alive, I fasted. I was crying. I don't know. Who knows if the Lord will be gracious that the child may live? But what? Go ahead.
But now he is dead. Wherefore should I fast?
But now he's dead. Give me something to eat. Go ahead.
Can I bring him back again? I shall go to him, but he shall not return to me.
I can't bring him back. I'm going to go to him, the grave. I'm going to be dead like him, but he ain't coming back to me. Go to Acts 20. Acts 20. Death is all over the Bible, brothers and sisters. Sometimes the Lord will bring them back. Sometimes he let them die. But it's all an interruption. Just like Martha said, I know I'm going to see him again in the resurrection. That's when the interruption is over. Acts 20 and verse 6. 20 and 6. Read it, man.
And we sailed away from Philippi after the days of unleavened bread and came unto them to Troas in five days, where we abode 7 days. And upon the first day of the week, when the disciples came together to break bread, Paul preached unto them, ready to depart in the morrow, and continued his speech until midnight.
So Paul was preaching a long time. Go ahead.
And there were many lights in the upper chamber, where they were gathered together. And there sat in a window a certain young man named Eutychus, being fallen into a deep sleep.
Now here's this man listening to the word of God being preached by Paul, and all of a sudden the cat fell asleep. And what happened?
And as Paul was long preaching, he sunk down with sleep and fell down from the third loft and was taken up dead.
The man fell out the window dead, sitting up there listening to the word of God. He nodded off, and next thing he know, he was dead. Which he don't know, because he wasn't dead for that long. But he didn't even know he was dead. Go ahead, verse 10.
And Paul went down and fell on him, and embracing him said, trouble not yourselves, for his life is in him. When he therefore was come up again, and had broken bread, and eaten, and talked a long while, even until break of day, so he departed. And they brought the young man alive, and were not a little comforted.
So now Paul brought the man back to life. But that's just, you know, who would have thought that would happen, man? That's like somebody up in here nodding off and falling the wrong way. You never know. People have fainted, hit their head, and broke their neck. Try nodding off, listen to the word of God, and dying. Paul ain't here to bring you back. That's why I tell you, if you're sleepy, stand up in the back. But anyway, let's move on, man. Go to 1 Kings 17. Because you know what's going to happen. If he fall asleep standing up, you must really be sleepy. Because you're going to hit that ground hard. 1 Kings 17. We're going to get through this. And verse 1. 17 and 1. Go ahead.
And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, therefore before whom I stand, there shall not be dew or rain these years, but according to my word. And the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, get thee hence, and turn thee eastward, and hide thyself by the brook Cherith, that is before Jordan. And it shall be that shall drink of the brook, and I shall command it the ravens to feed thee there. So he went and did according to the word of the Lord. For he went and dwelt by the brook of Cherith, that is before Jordan. And the ravens brought him bread and flesh in the morning, and bread and flesh in the evening, and he drank of the brook. And it came to pass, after a while, that the brook dried up, because there had been no rain in the land.
So the Lord told Elijah to tell Ahab, ain't gonna be no rain for 3 years. And Elijah, you go over there by this brook, and I'm gonna have the ravens to bring you some flesh in the morning and some bread in the evening, and you're gonna drink from this brook till it dry up. Now skip down to verse 17 and read it.
And it came to pass after these things that the son of the woman, the mistress of the house, fell sick, and his sickness was so sore that there was no breath left in him.
So in the meantime, he sent her to a widow's house to where he could get fed. But she didn't have much. But he told her, look, give me mine first, and I'll make sure that you eat good. And she did. But it came to pass, you know, her son got sick. Go ahead.
And he said unto Elijah, what have I do with thee, thou man of God? Art thou come unto me to call my sin to remembrance and to slay my son?
And she forgot, you know, all that good stuff he just did for, you know. So she's just lashing out at him. She's like, what I got to do with you, old man of God? You remember my sins? You come to kill my son. 19, go ahead.
And he said unto her, give me thy son.
Give me your son. Go ahead.
And he took him out of her bosom and carried him up unto Aloft, where he abode and laid upon him his own bed. And he cried unto the Lord and said, Lord, O Lord my God, hast thou also brought evil upon the window, whom I sojourned by slaying her son?
So now he petitioned the Lord. He said, look, O Lord my God, hast thou brought evil upon the widow by killing her son? Go ahead.
And he stretched himself upon the child 3 times and cried unto the Lord, saying, O Lord my God, I pray thee, let this child's soul come into him again. And the Lord heard the voice of Elijah, and the soul of the child came unto him again, and he revived.
So the Lord brought the child back to life. Go ahead.
And Elijah took the child and brought him down out of the chamber into the house and delivered him unto his mother. And Elijah said, see, thy son liveth. And the woman said to Elijah, now by this I know that thou art a man of God, and that the word of the Lord in thy mouth is truth.
So now he brought her son back to life by the hand of God. It's hard to see kids die, man. That's when I go to funerals. I don't want to. It's rough to see child in the casket, man. Man, innocent kids, they ain't did nothing. Go to Luke chapter 13. Luke 13. But the Lord brought the child back to life. The woman was mad too, boy. She was upset. Luke 13. And pick it up at verse 1. 13 and 1. Let's look at this instance where a lot of people got killed. 13 and
1. There is present at the season some that told him of the Galileans, whose blood Pilate had mingled with their sacrifices. And Jesus answering said unto them, suppose ye that these Galileans were sinners above all the Galileans, because they suffered such things. I tell you nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish.
So he told them, look, they told him about what Pilate did. They was in that sacrifice, and Pilate killed a bunch of people. And Jesus said unto them, look, you think these people were sinners above all because they died in that manner? He was like, no, they wasn't. But unless you repent, you're going to perish the same way. Go ahead.
Or those 18 upon whom the tower of Siloam fell and slew them.
So now here's a tower fell on 18 people and they died. Who would have thought that was going to happen? They didn't wake up in the morning thinking the tower was going to fall on them. Everybody's pretty much going about their daily routine. And then a tower fall on you and kill you. Time and chance happen to all of us suddenly. Go ahead.
Think ye that they were sinners above all men that dwelt in Jerusalem? I tell you, nay. But except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish.
So we got to understand, just because people die, it don't mean they did something wrong. Because remember, Job didn't do nothing wrong, but a whole lot of stuff happened to him. So we don't have no finger to point at nobody. They died because, you know, they was a prostitute or dope fiend. You don't know. Nobody knows but God. 1 Samuel 28. Pick it up at verse 1. Read it, man. 15, I'm sorry. I'm trying to get through this. Read, man.
And Samuel said to Saul, why hast thou disquieted me?
So now we know the story. Samuel died. Saul didn't have nobody to talk to about petitioning the Lord for. So what did he do? Went to see a woman with a familiar spirit, which was a no-no. Told her that, you know, divine up who I tell you. He thought he was talking to Samuel. Keep reading.
To bring me up. And Saul answered, I am sore distressed, for the Philistines make war against me, and God is departed from me, and answers me no more, neither by prophets nor by dreams. Therefore I have called thee, that thou mayest make known unto me what I shall do.
So he wanted to know about the Philistines, man. They're coming against me. Tell me something, Sam. Go ahead.
Then says Samuel, wherefore then dost thou ask of me, seeing the Lord is departed from thee, and is become thine enemy? And the Lord had done to him as he spake by me, for the Lord had rent the kingdom out of thine hand, and given it unto thy neighbor, even to David.
So why are you talking to me? If the Lord ain't talking to you, what can I tell you? But I tell you what, 18.
Because thou obeyest not the voice of the Lord, nor executest his fierce wrath upon Amalek, therefore hath the Lord done this thing unto thee this day.
Because you didn't listen to the Lord, that's why this is happening to you. Verse 19, go ahead.
Moreover, the Lord will also deliver Israel with thee unto the hand of the Philistines.
So the Philistines going to take Israel, man. And what else?
And tomorrow shalt thou and thy sons be with me.
And tomorrow you and your boys going to be dead just like me.
The Lord also shall deliver the host of Israel into the hands of the Philistines.
So here's another guy, other than Hezekiah and Jesus, who knew they was going to die. The man told him, look, tomorrow you're going to be dead, dude. Tomorrow. Now, if somebody told me that, I wouldn't have went to war. But he went anyway because he had an evil spirit on him, just like Ahab, you know. The Lord wanted Ahab to go up to Ramah Gilead so he could kill him. They told him, 400 prophets told him go up, he didn't believe him. One good prophet told him, go on up there, man, because the Lord wants to kill you. That's why he put that lying spirit into your prophets. But he went anyway, tried to disguise himself, he ended up getting killed. Read some more, man. Let's see what happened to him after he heard that news.
Then Saul fell straightway all along on the earth and was sore afraid.
That's what that Long Island medium woman should be telling these cats when they come to talk to their dead ones. Your papa said, you're going to be dead with me tomorrow. Bet she wouldn't have no TV show. But keep reading. I'm sorry.
Because of the words of Samuel, and there was no strength in him, for he had eaten no bread all the day, nor all the night.
So the man was sick. After he heard them words, go ahead.
And the woman came unto Saul and saw that he was sore troubled and said unto him, behold, thine handmaid hath obeyed thy voice, and I have put my life into thy hand and have hearkened unto thy word when thou spakest unto me. Now therefore, I pray thee, hearken thou unto the voice of thine handmaid, and let me set a morsel of bread before thee and eat, that thou mayest have strength when thou goest on thy way. But he refused and said, I will not eat. But his servants, together with the woman, compelled him, and he hearkened unto their voice. So he rose up from the earth and sat upon the bed.
But now he didn't want to eat nothing. They, look, man, you going to eat. You got to eat. So they made him something. What did she make him? Go ahead.
And the woman had a fat calf in the house, and she hasted it and killed it and took flour and kneaded it, and did bake unleavened bread thereof. And she brought it before Saul and before his servants that they did eat. Then they rose up and went away that night.
They went away that night, right unto their death. Go to Matthew 2. Chapter 2. Strong words coming from an evil spirit, huh? You're going to die tomorrow, partner. Betty wasn't expecting to hear that. Matthew 2 and verse 16. Let's look at these. Children, man. From a crazy man. Had them all killed. Them kids wasn't doing nothing but being little kids. 2 years old and under. 2 and 16. What it say?
Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise men, was exceeding wroth.
He was mad. Go ahead.
And sent forth and slew all the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coasts thereof, the 2 year olds and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men.
So now 2 years old and under got killed. You can just imagine, just kids out there playing, they ain't doing nothing. Soldiers come through and just chop them up. Go to Exodus 1. Let's look at some old kids. But we know they're coming up. It's hard, though, when kids die, man. It's rough. And those of us that have experienced that, y'all know how it is. Exodus 1 and 15. What it say?
And the king of Egypt spake to the Hebrew midwives, of which the name of the one was Sipporah, and the name of the other Puah. And he said, when ye do the office of a midwife to the Hebrew women, and see them upon the stools, if it be a son, then ye shall kill him.
So if you see a son, Israelite woman have a son, it's kill her. Go ahead.
But if it be a daughter, then she shall live.
But if it's a girl, save it. Go ahead.
But the midwives feared God and did not as the king of Egypt commanded them, but saved the men children alive.
But they feared the Lord and did what? They saved the men children. They didn't kill them. So he had to take matters into his own hands. 22, what it say?
And Pharaoh charged all his people, saying, every son that is born ye shall cast into the river, and every daughter ye shall save alive.
So he told all the Egyptians, look, every son that is born, throw it in the river. And that was probably the Nile River, and the Nile River got some of the biggest crocodiles on the planet. And I'm quite sure they was eating good, because the book say Israel was multiplying like rabbits. So he put it in the hands of the people. All you gotta do is when you hear some crying, you know, you can see the Israelite woman walking around with a big belly, you know she's about to have a baby. You hear some crying, go on over there and look and see. If it's a boy, give it him. Throw him in the river. That's a shame. Job 1. Look what happened to Job, verse 13. Go ahead.
And there was a day when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house.
Now here's Job and his kids, you know. They was eating and drinking in their oldest brother's house. Skip down to verse 17 and read it.
While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the Chaldeans made out of three bands and fell upon the camels, and I carried them away, yea, and slain the servants with the edge of the sword. And I only am escaped alone to tell thee.
So all this bad stuff started happening to Job. Took his livestock, his sheep, his oxen, camels, everything. Go ahead.
While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, thy sons and thy daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house.
So all his kids were in their oldest brother's house eating and drinking, just having a good old time like they always do. And what happened?
And behold, there came a great wind from the wilderness and smote the four corners of the house, and it fell upon the young men, and they are dead, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee.
So all of a sudden the wind come along and the house just collapsed on them. Kill them all. Keep reading.
Then Job arose, rent his mantle, and shaved his head, and fell down upon the ground and worshipped, and said, naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly.
So Job was a perfect and upright man. He didn't do nothing. But the man lost all his wealth and all his kids in one swoop and still praised the Lord, a true servant of God. Anybody else would have put a bullet in their head or jumped out the window. Genesis 23. That's enough of the kids dying, man. Let's get to some old people. Genesis 23, because it's good. It's a blessing to live a good, ripe old age. To see your kids prosper, your grandkids, great-grandkids. Read.
And Sarah was 107 and 20 years old. These were the years of the life of Sarah.
So Sarah was Abraham's wife. She was 127 years old when she died. And she only had one son, Isaac. And had him when she was, what, 90? 90-year-old woman having babies. You know that's coming from the Lord. But keep reading.
And Sarah died in Kiriath Arba. The same is Hebron in the land of Canaan. And Abram came to mourn for Sarah and to weep for her.
So that's what happens when you die, you know. People around your loved ones, they cry and they weep because it's a sad occasion. Every funeral, somebody crying. Ain't nobody in there that ain't shed no tears. Whether you screaming and hollering out loud or, you know, sniffling and trying to hold them back. but there's some mourning somewhere. Go ahead.
And Abraham stood up from his before his dead and spake unto the sons of Heth, saying, I am a stranger and a sojourner with you. Give me a possession of a burying place with you, that I may bury my dead out of my sight. And the children of Heth answered Abram, saying unto him, Hear us, my lord. Thou art a mighty prince among us. In the choice of our sepulchres, bury thy dead. None of us shall withhold from thee his sepulchre, but that thou mayest bury thy dead.
So when you live a long life, you know, you start planning for your death, because the Bible says the living know they're going to die. So as the older you get, you know you can't live forever. So Abraham was out buying him a burial plot, first for his wife, and then later on when he died, we're going to read, he got buried there too. So that's what people do as they get older and know they're going to die. They have their death set in order. Keep reading.
And Abraham stood up and bowed himself to the people of the land, even to the children of Heth.
Skip down to 25, I'm sorry. So he bought that plot of land or the burial place, buried Sarah, and now he died. Let's see what happened to him. 25 and verse 7, read it.
And these are the days of the years of Abraham's life, which he lived, 175 years.
So he was 175 years when he died. Go ahead.
Then Abraham gave up the ghost and died in a good old age.
A good old age, man. 175, that's a good old age. Go ahead.
An old man and full of years, and was gathered to his people. And his sons Isaac and Ishmael buried him in the caves of Machpelah, and the field of Ephron, the son of Zohar the Hittite, which is before Mamre. The field which Abraham purchased of the sons of Heth, there was Abraham buried, and Sarah his wife.
So he was buried next to his wife, Sarah. Deuteronomy 19. Deuteronomy 19. And we almost done. Even though we started a little late, it's all right. It gets dark later now. Deuteronomy 19 and verse 5. Read it.
As when a man goeth into the wood with his neighbor to hew wood.
So now here's two people, two brothers going out to chop some wood up. What happened?
And his hand fetches a stroke with the axe to cut down a tree, and his head slippeth from the helve and lighteth upon his neighbor that he die, he shall flee one of those cities and live.
So they out chopping wood. All of a sudden, the axe head slip off the handle and cut this dude up and kill him. Just like that. Skip down to verse 11.
But if any man had hate his neighbor, and lie in wait for him, and rise up against him, and smite him mortally that he die, and fleeth into one of these cities.
So now you got some premeditated murder going on here. One was accidental. The other one is this guy, he got it in for him, and he gonna kill him. That happens today as well. You got involuntary manslaughter. And you got first-degree murder. People that are killed accidentally and people that are killed on purpose. But either way, their life is interrupted. Go ahead.
Then the elders of the city shall send and fetch him thence and deliver him into the land of the avenger of blood, that he may die.
So now this cat killed this dude, and now he on the run. He went to the city of refuge, but hey, man, you're guilty. Why are you running for safety? So they're going to get him. 13, what they going to do to him?
Thine eyes shall not pity him, but thou shalt put away the guilt of innocent blood from Israel.
Okay, that it, go ahead.
That it may go well with thee.
Numbers 9. Numbers 35, I'm sorry. Numbers 35. This is the last long one. And 9, read that.
And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, when ye be come over Jordan into the land of Canaan, then ye shall appoint you cities to be cities of refuge for you, that the slayer may flee thither, which killeth any person at unaware.
So now they had cities of refuge. When you got into the land, it was places where if somebody killed somebody accidentally, they could go to one of these cities till the judges, you know, make a diligent inquiry to see what happened, because kill somebody, guess what? If they got anybody living, they coming to get you. They coming to get you. So you flee to one of these cities and let the elders or the judges see what happened. Go ahead.
And they shall be unto you cities for refuge from the avenger, that the manslayer die not until he stand before the congregation in judgment. And of these cities which ye shall give, 6 cities shall ye have for refuge. Ye shall give these cities on this side Jordan, and 3 cities shall ye give in the land of Canaan, which shall be cities of refuge.
So the cities of refuge, 6 cities, go ahead.
These 6 cities shall be a refuge, both for the children of Israel, and for the stranger, and for the sojourner among them, that every one that killeth any person unawares may flee thither.
So this is accidental death. You can flee to one of these cities, so the brother or the uncle, whoever it is, don't come and get you, exact some revenge. But what if you do it on purpose? Verse 16.
And if he smite him with an instrument of iron.
Don't people get beat with clubs today? Go ahead.
So that he die, he is a murderer.
He's a murderer. What's going to happen to him?
The murderer shall surely be put to death.
Kill him. Go ahead.
And if you smite him with throwing a stone.
Beat somebody with a brick. Go ahead.
Wherewith he may die, and he die, he is a murderer.
He's a murderer.
The murderer shall surely be put to death.
Kill him. Go ahead.
Or if he smite him with a hand weapon of wood.
Baseball bat. Weapon of wood. Go ahead.
Wherewith he may die, and he die, he is a murderer. The murderer shall surely be put to death.
I remember when I was in Chicago, my pops used to take us to the games when we was little. He'd always take us on the days where they was giving away stuff so he could get his money back. And he would take us pretty much every year we'd go on bat day. And they would be handing out them Louisville Sluggers, boy. But they stopped that. That was free ammunition. They was beating people with them bats, man. But anyway, put him to death. Go ahead.
The revenger of blood himself shall slay the murderer. When he meeteth them, he shall slay him. But if he thrust them of hatred, or hurl at him by laying of weight that he die, or in enmity smite him with his hand that he die, he that smote him shall surely be put to death, for he is a murderer. The revenger of blood shall slay the murderer when he meeteth him. But if he thrust him suddenly without enmity, or cast upon him anything without laying of weight, or with any stone wherewith a man may die, seeing him not, and cast it upon him that he die, and was not his enemy, neither sought his harm, then the congregation shall judge between the slayer and the revenger of blood according to these judgments.
So now if the revenger happened to come up on him and he kill him, then the revenger's in trouble. But if he did something suddenly, without enmity or having cast upon him then, and he don't die, then they gotta sort this thing out. Keep reading, man.
And the congregation shall deliver the slayer out of the hand of the revenger of blood. And the congregation shall restore him to the city of his refuge, where he was fled. And he shall abide in it until the death of the high priest, which was anointed with the holy oil. But if the slayer shall at any time come without the border of the city of his refuge, whither he was fled, and the revenger of blood find him without the borders of the city of his refuge, and an revenger of blood kill the slayer, he shall not be guilty of blood, because he should have remained in the city of his refuge until the death of the high priest. But after the death of the high priest, the slayer shall return into the land of his possession.
So now the slayer is supposed to stay in the city as long as the high priest is living, because that's his protection. Otherwise, because his family members, the person that he killed, they want some blood. And y'all protecting this dude, but remember, it was an accident. But still, they don't think that. Just like my brother, he killed two people. Fell asleep at the wheel, car flipped over, cut their heads off. They hated him. Even though it was an accident, the hate is still there. And if they could get their hands on you, guess what? They will kill you. That's the mentality people have. But because he left the city before the time was up, and word got back to the revenger, kill him. He went and took him out because he didn't hang around his protection. So now he's fair game. And couldn't nothing happen to the revenger. But we see death is going around everywhere. Go to Job 14. Interruption in life. But what happens when the interruption is over? Let's see. Job 14. Because interruptions are momentarily, temporary. They don't last forever. If the movie breaks right in the middle, guess what? They get some tape and tape it up and show it again. A momentary interruption. That's the way death is. It's momentary. This first death does not last forever. Only the second one does. And then that's another lesson. Job 14 and verse 1. What it say?
Man that is born of a woman is a few days and full of trouble.
That's true, boy. Man that is born of a woman, few days and full of trouble. Go ahead.
He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. He fleeth also as a shadow and continueth not.
That's how quick your life is. He cometh forth like a flower and is cut down. He fleeth also as a shadow and continueth not. Skip down to verse 10 and read it.
But man dieth and wasteth away. Yea, man giveth up the ghost. And where is he?
Man dies and does what? Waste away. He turns to the dust. He giveth up the ghost. And where is he? Go ahead.
As the waters fail from the sea, and the flood decayeth and drieth up, so a man lieth down and riseth not. Till the heavens be no more, they shall not awake, nor be raised out of their sleep.
So man lieth down, and he don't get up till the heavens be no more. Go ahead.
Oh, that thou wouldest hide me in the grave, that thou wouldest keep me secret until thy wrath be past, that thou wouldest appoint me a set time and remember me.
Oh, that thou wouldest hide me in the grave. That's where your hiding place is, till the Lord's wrath is past, in the grave, dead. Go ahead.
If a man die, shall he live again?
That's a good question. If a man dies, shall he live again? Go ahead.
All the days of my appointed time will I wait till my change come.
All the days of my appointed time, I'm going to wait. Where? In the grave. Till my change come. So in other words, interruption is over. Go to John 5. John chapter 5. Daniel. Yeah, man, Daniel. Daniel 12. Y'all got me messed up. Daniel 12. Let's let the Bible confirm that, where you're going to be hiding at. All this stuff about going to heaven, you can't even read that in the book. And that's where they put everybody at every funeral. In heaven. In heaven. Daniel 12:1, what it say?
And at the time shall Michael stand up, and the great prince of stand, and a great prince which standeth for the children of thy people. And there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that same time. And that at that time thy people shall be delivered, every one that shall be found written in the book.
That's another lesson, but verse 2 is what I want. Go ahead.
And many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake.
And many of them that sleep where? In the dust of the earth. Didn't we read that in Genesis? Till thou return to the ground, for dust thou art, and unto dust shalt thou return. They're going to wake up to what?
Some to everlasting life.
Those that did it right while they was living. Go ahead.
And some to shame and everlasting contempt.
And shame and everlasting contempt 1,000 years later. But they sleeping where? In the dust. And the Lord going to wake them up. He's going to wake you up out of your sleep. Because that's what death is. Sleep. Go on in there and wake him up. He's asleep. That's what you do, right? You shake him. Sometimes it's hard to wake people up when they're in that deep sleep. You can slap them across the face. They won't wake up. Shake them. They may get their eyes half open and go right back to sleep. And you get some, pour some cold water on them. They'll wake up then. But they will sleep. But this death sleep, only God can wake you up out of that. John 5:28, read it.
Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the grave shall hear his voice.
All that are in the graves, keep that in mind. They in the grave, they gonna hear the voice, go ahead.
And shall come forth.
And they coming up, go ahead.
They that have done good unto the resurrection of life.
The one that did good to the resurrection of life, just like Martha told Jesus, I'm going to see Lazarus in the resurrection. Go ahead.
And they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation.
So you're coming up. Whether you know, like we read, there's one event that comes to all the good, the bad, the evil, the wicked. You're going to die. Everybody going to get that interruption. But then once you wake up, how did you live before the interruption? Isaiah 26, 1 verse, 19. It's going to tell you the same thing. Read it.
Thy dead men shall live. Together with thy my dead body shall they arise. Awake and sing, ye that dwell in dust. For thy dew is as the dew of herbs, and the earth shall cast out the dead.
So the dead man, thy dead men shall live. Together with my dead body, they shall arise, awake, and sing, ye that dwell in the dust. All throughout the Bible is telling you where you are. In the ground. John 6. Just because you get cremated, it means you just got to the dust faster. That's it. Because they put all this stuff in you anyway to preserve you, just in case they got to exhume you. But hey, all it's doing is prolonging you turning into the dust. They found that dude, what was his King Tut? They found his, you know, he wasn't nobody, he was dust, pretty much. Some of it was intact, a few bones here and there, but hey, he still turned to the, leave him in there a little bit longer. You would have opened it up. Found nothing but dust or some bandages, whatever they wrapped them up in. I don't know. Ace bandages. Anyway, John, what, 6:34. Read it, man.
Then they said unto him, Lord, evermore give us this bread. And Jesus said to them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you, that ye also have seen me, and believe not. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven, not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me.
What is his will? Go ahead.
And this is the Father's will which has sent me, that of all which he had given me, I should not lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day.
But I should raise it up again at the last day. Verse 40. Keep reading, I'm sorry.
And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day.
So the will of him that sent me, everyone that seeth the Son and believeth on him, you got everlasting life coming up. And you're going to get raised up at the last day. Skip down to 44 and read it.
No man can come to me except the Father which has sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day.
Raise him up the last day. 54, what it says?
Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day.
The last day. You die right, you're going to get raised up. Go to 1 Thessalonians. Let's look at it. 1 Thessalonians 4. This is when the interruption is over with. You're coming up. And you're going to live eternally. At the last day. 4 and 13, read it.
But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope.
So now Paul is giving them some encouragement. He said, look, don't be ignorant concerning them that are asleep. What you mean asleep? In other words, they dead. Don't be sorrowing like others that have no hope. 14, go ahead.
For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with them.
So if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even those of them that died in Jesus, God is going to bring with them. How are you going to do that? Go ahead.
For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first.
So the Lord is going to descend from heaven with a shout. That means he's calling them people that's in the grave, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ going to rise first. The ones that died right in Jesus, they coming up first. Go ahead.
Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord.
And that's what Jesus said. We read it earlier. If you believe in me, even though you lose your life, you're going to live. And if you believe in me, you won't die. And we see it right here. Those that are alive and remain will be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. These people didn't die. They was alive when Jesus came back. And that's going to be something to see right there, boy. If you're blessed enough to see it. 1 Corinthians 15, pick it up at verse 12. And this whole chapter is talking about dead folks. And let's see what it say. 12, 15 and 12, read it.
Now, if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, how say some among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? But if there is no resurrection of the dead, then is Christ not risen? And if Christ not be risen, then is our preaching vain, and your faith is also vain.
So it's not to be preached that there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ didn't come up. And if he didn't come up, why am I here? Why are you here? But we know he did. Go ahead.
Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God, because we have testified of God that he had raised up Christ, whom he raised not up, if so be that the dead rise not. For if the dead rise not, then is not Christ raised. And if Christ be not raised, your faith is vain. Ye are yet in your sins. And then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. If in this life only we have hope in Christ, We are, of all men, most miserable.
So if Christ didn't rise from the dead and we believing in him, we pretty much out the back door, man, because, hey, what we doing here? He didn't rise. Why are we here preaching he did? Ain't no resurrection. But we know that's false. Go ahead.
But now is Christ risen from the dead.
But Christ is risen from the dead. And his interruption was only 3 days. 3 days, man. That's how long he was dead. And then what did he do? He came up out of that grave with an eternal body. Go ahead.
And become the first fruits of them that slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive.
So as in Adam all die, we read that in Genesis. Even as in Christ, all shall be made alive, because you got to believe in Jesus. We read that, so you can get eternal life. Go ahead.
But every man in his own order. But
there's an order to things. Go ahead.
Christ is the first fruit.
Christ is the first one. He's the only one that has ever died and came up out the grave with an immortal body. He's the only one. Everybody else that has still died is still in the grave, or wherever else they died, they're there. The Lord will bring them back. They could have died in the ocean. All them babies that got thrown in the Nile River, they got ate up. And they became crocodile dung or shark dung, whatever it was. The Lord gonna bring them back. Go ahead.
But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruits. Afterwards, they are that are Christ at his coming. Then cometh to the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and all power. For he must reign till he hath put all enemies under his feet.
So he must reign until all enemies are under his feet. And what is that last enemy? Go ahead.
The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death.
The last enemy that's going to be destroyed is death. Won't be no more interruption after this. You're going to live forever. You will live forever. Skip down to verse 35 and read it. 35. Read it.
But some men will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened, except it die. And that which thou sowest not that body that shall be, but bear again.
Bear
grain. It may chance of wheat or of some other grain, but God giveth it a body that it hath pleased them, and to every seed his own body.
So now, some say how the dead raise and what body do they come? They trying to think, okay, they went in like this, what body they going to have coming out? It's going to be an immortal body. It's going to be immortal, because we're going to let the book tell you. Go ahead.
All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of men, another flesh of beasts, another of fishes, and another of birds. There are also celestial bodies and bodies terrestrial, but the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another. There is one glory of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars. For one star differeth from another star in glory.
So everything ain't the same. Even with the stars, you got different stars out there. Everything's different. Go ahead.
So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption.
So is the resurrection of the dead. It's sown in corruption. It goes in there. It goes into the ground, a corruptible body, but it comes up incorruptible. Go ahead.
It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown in a natural body. It is raised in a spiritual body.
So that's what you're going to have. It's sown a natural body, but when you come out that ground, guess what? You got you a spiritual body. Go ahead.
There is a natural body, and there is a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit. Howbeit, that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterwards that which is spiritual. The first man is one of the earth, earthy.
So the first man was Adam. He was made from the dust. He's earthy. Go ahead.
The second man is the Lord from heaven. The
second man is Jesus. He wasn't made from the dust. He came from heaven. Go ahead.
As is the earthy, such are they also that are earthy. And as is the heavenly, such are they also that are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the earthy.
So we have borne the image of the earthy. But what's the ultimate result? Go ahead.
We shall also bear the image of the heavenly.
We're going to have that spiritual body. We're going to get it. Go ahead.
Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Neither doth corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed.
Now, everybody ain't going to die, but you're going to get that change. When? Go ahead.
In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed.
So the trumpet's going to sound, and the dead is going to be raised incorruptible. And we all going to be changed. Go ahead.
For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. For so when this corruptible shall put on corruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be put to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory.
So when you get that immortal body, which means you can't die no more, that means there's no more need for death. There's no more need for no interruption of your life if you're going to live forever. So we've got to get rid of this death. Keep going.
Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, which given us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
So now let's go to the last place. Let's look at death being swallowed up in victory. Revelation 20. So death is nothing but an interruption, man, I'm telling you. And once the interruption is over, we got to get rid of death. It's got to go. Because there ain't no dying when you're living forever. Revelation 20 and verse 1. 20 and 1, read.
And I saw the angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he had laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil, and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. And cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nations no more, till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosed a little season.
So now he got to lock Satan up for 1,000 years. And he going to let him out. Go ahead.
And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus, and for the word of God, and which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received a mark upon their foreheads or in their hand, in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years.
So you know you got to be immortal to be living for 1,000 years. What is that called? Go ahead.
But the rest of the dead live not again until the 1,000 years were finished. This is the first resurrection.
So everybody ain't coming up in the first resurrection. Everybody's not coming up. Skip down to verse 11. Let's get to the
verse 6.
Read 6 too then.
Blessed and holy is he that hath part in the first resurrection. On such the second death hath no power. But they shall be priests of God and of Christ, and shall reign with him 1,000 years.
Wait a minute. The second death, you mean there's two deaths? Yes, it is. One is an interruption. The other one ain't no interruption. You there, dying every day for the rest of your life, burning up, on fire, worms eating on you, all kind of foul stuff. But that's another lesson. Skip down to verse 11. This is 1,000 years later when the rest of the dead is coming up. Read it.
And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face on the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God.
So we saw the dead, small and great, stand before God. Go ahead.
And the books were open.
And the books were open. They're going to open up the books on you. Just like they do when you're in court. They open up the books and read them laws that you broke. So the books were open, and another book was open. Go ahead.
And another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works.
And the dead were judged out of those things that were written in the books according to their works. So while you living, you got to get this thing right. I'm telling you, because you don't know when your number's up. You don't know. Because if I knew, believe me, I'd wait till the day before. But then we don't know that. Keep reading though, man.
And the sea gave up the dead which were in it.
So if you died in the sea, the Lord gonna bring you back. Go ahead.
And death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them.
So the grave delivered up the dead. Go ahead.
And they were judged every man according to their works.
So everybody was judged according to their works. The ones that sleep in the dust. 14, what it say?
And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death.
So death and hell were cast where? Into the lake of fire. No more death. You don't need no more death if everybody's living forever. If nobody can die, what's the use of having death? You don't need it, so you get rid of it. The last enemy that's to be destroyed is death. And that's what Jesus did. Cast death and hell into the lake of fire. And who else? Go ahead.
And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire.
And whosoever was not found written in the book of life, guess what? You died again. But this time, there was no interruption from this one. And I hope you got some understanding. In Jesus' name.
We welcome you and hope today's lesson increased your knowledge of the Holy Bible. CDs and DVDs of the Sabbath lesson are available. Please place your order and donation in an offering envelope, and it will be filled on the next Sabbath. The children's class ages 5 through 12 starts at the same time as the adult Sabbath lesson in the assigned location. Bring your child so that their knowledge may be increased. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. Proverbs 22, verse 6. Adult question and answer is from 4:30 to 6:30 after the Sabbath lesson. We have question and answer every Wednesday at 5 p.m. via telephone conference line. The number and access code are located in the top of the lesson, or see the live stream of the question and answer at www.thykingdomcome7.com. If you're interested in being baptized, please place your name on the list at the literature table. Remember to follow the dress code when attending our services. Men should remove all hats and all head coverings during the service times. Women should wear a head covering, such as a hat or a scarf during the service. Women should not wear tight-fitting pants or shirts or revealing clothing. Attire should be modest according to the Bible. If your child becomes restless during a Bible lesson, we encourage you to remove your child from the room until he or she has settled. Your tithes and offerings are always appreciated. Please place your tithes and offerings in an offering envelope and deposit it in the offering box. Your cooperation is very appreciated. Again, thank you for coming, and we hope to see you on the next Sabbath. Peace.
Peace. Okay, just a couple of announcements. We're going to have the all hands cleanup on April the 14th, which is a Sunday, to get the establishment prepared for the feast. So those that are willing to help out, you greatly appreciate it. We're going to start a little early so we can get everything done and then relax. But the more hands we have on deck, you know, the faster we can get done. We're going to also, we're going to set it up for the Passover as well. So, because that's coming up on the 18th, which is a Thursday at sundown, we're going to have a service here, which also is from Thursday sundown to Friday sundown, which takes you into the weekly Sabbath, also the first night of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So keep that in mind. Also, we had Brother Greg's memorial last Sunday, and it's kind of, you know, it's funny how, you know, his relatives, you know, how he came across to us, his personality and all that. It was surprising to them that, you know, he was the same way, you know, even before he was in the troops. You know, his personality was the same way. The brother was cool, you know, they appreciated us, those of us that showed up, you know, they welcomed us and, you know, told a few stories about him, and that was pretty much it. But, you know, it was a good thing, you know. And I remember what Elijah said a long time ago after the last funeral we did. He said, "You probably gonna do the next one," you know, and sure enough, because that's what a memorial is, a funeral without a body. So, but it was, you know, it was good. We had a good time, and the brother will be missed. But like the lesson said, you know, death is just an interruption. And if his garments was white, you know, we will see him again. There's still more sign up sheet for the feast. It's on the kitchen door. There's still some more spaces open for dishes. I see about, you know, still three more chicken places that ain't nobody signed up for. That should be the first thing that's filled up is chicken. But anyway, also, we got a lunch, a little potluck that goes on. You know, the parents, make sure your children eat outside, and the adults help clean up as long as we go along throughout the day. Potluck is to be respected and enjoyed by all, so please respect the class and keep it clean. Also, I have an announcement. Let's pay more attention. Last week, a woman, walked in while we were either finishing eating lunch or doing the women's prayer. A speaker belonging to the choir came up missing. If anybody sees it, how did somebody get up in here, man? All right, so keep that in mind. If anybody sees anyone out of place, let one of the brothers know. Anybody. What else? There was something else too. Oh yeah, we'll bless the food, you know, after we close out, we'll bless the food. As always, you know, keep everybody in prayer. Because, you know, we all going through some things, and we definitely need each other. Pray for one another. And that's pretty much it. So we're going to bless the food and close out. But let's go ahead and stand up, face Jerusalem. Heavenly Father, God, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, as we come together as a commandment to keep the Sabbath day and keep it holy, we ask that you bless the food that we're about to receive and that it nourish our bodies and that we may continue to remember the Sabbath, keep it holy, and have these food offerings for us to eat. Our Father, which art in heaven, Hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
Thy will be done in earth.
As it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread.
And forgive us our debts.
As we forgive our debtors.
And lead us not into temptation.
But deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom.
And the power.
And the glory.
Forever.
Praise the Lord.
For he is good.
For his mercy endureth forever.
Praise the Lord God of Israel.
For he is good.
For his mercy endureth forever.
In Jesus' name we pray.
The Holy One of Israel.
The Mighty One of Jacob.
The King of Kings.
And Lord of Lords.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
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 In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Hey, sis, one real quick.